So this is explains zebralite pattern in phase preference in alloys. And what we do now, we just like what we did in nucleation in Zeldovich, we write down a kind of a diffusion equation kind of scenario, and then we go into that. And I'll now this time I'll describe a little bit more of what you mean by diffusion equation and how these things develops little bit more detail. Okay, now let us consider diffusion equation. This you know from your undergraduate very very well, and it is actually just a part of time dependent statistical mechanics, which we will do much more later, but we need a little bit of it here, and it is very very easy. This gradient, this quantity gradient here is a three dimension, it is three dimensional vector, that means d dx, d dy, d dz, nothing to be a, and j is the current term. So this is called conservation of mass, that I take the derivative of position dependent composition C, and composition C is xA minus xB. Then this is the just the statement of the continuity, we will call it continuity equation, is a statement of law of conservation. That means if I have a like that, then I take an area a here, then the particle coming there, if and then I want to consider change what is happening here, then the change inside will be the amount coming in and the amount going out, and flux is the J. So dj dx, if this x, that will be dc dt, and there is a minus because it is more going out, it will be less, and it is more than, so this is nothing but the continuity equation, and this is the one that we just describing. So this is the continuity equation, just the conservation, but that means we essentially say particle cannot be created or particle cannot be destroyed. So it is a, it is intimately connected with law of conservation. But a continuity equation is a very very simple thing, and you might have faced it in your undergraduate, you know, in electrochemistry chapter and simple and kinetic theory chapter. Now we know one more thing, this equation by itself is not complete because there are two unknowns. Now what is done is something is extremely nice, which is called Fick's law. Remember what is Fick's law? Fick's law is, now this is an exact, this is an exact, but Fick's law is not exact, but Fick's law is an assumption. Fick's law tells that the flux is derivative of chemical potential. So if there is more chemical potential, then matter flows from large chemical potential to lower chemical potential. Here I use U as a chemical potential. So Fick's law is a what you call constitutive relation, it is an assumption, and this assumption, as one tells, it is kind of within linear regime, that means small fluctuation regime, it is valid. So this you can read these things in Google, you can read these things little in Wikipedia, but these are very very fundamental, very very nice things. So this is my chemical potential, they are essentially saying matter flows from large chemical potential, low chemical potential, large free energy to low free energy. However, it flows with a rate, and that rate is the diffusion d by kbt, okay, and kbt is put in here, if you could have guessed it, it is because that kbt can as well go in the chemical potential. So this is a dimension of energy, kbt is dimension of energy, so u by kbt is dimensionless. This, as you can see here, is j comes because this the concentration, this is composition or concentration, so 1 over L cube, and this is L cube by T, this flux is L square, remember amount of matter per unit area per second, right. So flux is L square by T, this is gradient, so you get number per area per unit time per area, so this is 1 over L square T, so gradient comes with 1 over L, so this is 1 over L cube T. This is 1 over L cube T dimensional analysis. So now So this is 1 over L square T flux. Now that this takes care of that, and this is energy taken care of, and this is 1 over L here, and D is L square by T, and so D is L square by T. So there is some interesting thing here. So D is diffusion L square by T. Bear with me for a minute, and 1 over L, and then it is M L square by T square, and that is then L L goes, then L cube by T cube, but I have a KBT, so that again T square by M L square, so that goes out, and 1 over L L L square by T, L by T, L by T, L by T, okay. If this is composition, then it is L by T, okay. So C is used as a composition, difference in mole fraction. So C is used as a dimensionless quantity. So if C is dimensionless quantity, then flux is 1 over L, and flux is number of particle by 1 over L square T, okay. So this is 1 over L square, 1 over L square is L square by T, and this is 1 over L, okay. So I think there is a something a bit screwy up here, but we have to continue, and I will fix it up sometime later, that these things, okay. So now we continue it. Now there is the issue, either I am doing something wrong here, likely most probably it is correct, but one of the notation used here probably is different from what I have in mind, but you can figure it out probably yourself. So okay, so now this is the, but the rest of the things is okay. This continued equation, this is continued equation, and this is the flux. This definition is correct, and the chemical potential, remember chemical potential is, chemical potential Z is dA free energy by density, that is the chemical potential. So here the chemical potential is similar, exactly same thing, here chemical potential is U, chemical potential is functional derivative of free energy with respect to composition or concentration, that because the, so this is an exactly same thing as that. But this is the functional, because C, this C is a, which is C is a, let me, so CR is XAR and minus XBR, and that is I think is my, my confusion. So this is a mole fraction, and this is a mole fraction of A, this is mole fraction of B. So I, if I have the particle like that, then I divide into grid. I am saying something very, very interesting, so please listen carefully. So then I choose one of them, and I say this is my location R, and in that location now I find out what, in this location which is R, I find out what is the number of A molecules and what is number of B molecules. So the, what is then that will give me the mole fraction, so A molecules minus B molecules. So that is the composition C. So the way to consider the position dependent composition is to consider your system divided into grid, and then each grid you go, you can make the grid very small, but do not make it too small so that it does not contain, they let it contain about 8 to 10 molecules, then you can see. So if, when they are 50-50 equal number of A and B, then you will have composition 0, but it varies from position to position, and because of the inhomogeneity that is being created, and also because of fluctuations, okay. So now, so this is the definition of composition. So when I take derivative of free energy with composition, that gives me chemical potential, just like in thermodynamics. So Fick's law is driven, Fick's law is diffusion gradient of chemical potential. this cavity might be the problem of the dimensional thing, but we can. Now, exactly what I said before, the free energy, I am going to create a inhomogeneity now. I am going to create the free energy, it is really a lot of fun now. I am going to create from here the homogeneous, where in every grid my C is 0. From there, now I am going to place where C is 1 and here and minus 1 here. So, I am going to create through this the heterogeneity. And I already told you the way to describe heterogeneity is Ginzburg-Landau. That I already told you that Ginzburg-Landau allows you to get this free energy. This is free energy as a FC. So, this FC, this quantity is, this is a lot of fun. This quantity is this thing. So, this is the thing FC. Okay. Now, and this is the energy you have to pay in order to create a heterogeneity. So, this is the surface tension term. So, this is the Landau term, which is the bare free energy, and this is the surface tension term, because I have to create surface. To create surface, I have to pay energy, and so combination of the two is it. So, now, if I want to see the WL, if I have to create the WL, and I know how to create the WL, and I know that is just Landau. Now, the beauty of these things that I can create single L to WL by saying if A is greater than 0, then I have a single L, that is a high temperature, then I quench to low temperature. When I quench to low temperature, A becomes negative. If A becomes negative and this changing, then this single one like that becomes something like that. So, that is a very clever way of doing. So, I can now use Landau free energy into Ginzburg-Landau, and I can do something very, very clever. Okay. So, I combine the diffusion equation dc dt. I had two things, one flux term, another term, one flux term, remember, one dc dt equal to minus del dot j, and I have a j term that is in terms of d by kbt delta u, and then u is in terms of del f delta c. These three things are combined here. So, there is one del here, another del here, that gives del square, d by kvt comes out, and the third part delta f del c, or the chemical potential system. So, three ingredients. So, I get the diffusion equation dc dt d by del square. Now, I can consider this equation in terms of fluctuation, but that can wait. We do not need to do that, we can work with this equation, this beautiful equation. Now, what we do is the following, we are almost done, that we consider just like we did in nucleation, exactly the Zeldovich and all these things, that we consider in infinitesimal fluctuations or position dependent composition. So, I said, okay, there is a fluctuation delta c. Then I go back, I said, okay, fc plus delta c is fc, and I write fc plus as a result of that fluctuation. As a result of this fluctuation, my free energy has undergone at a position r some small change. How do I do that now? Okay, I go back my Ginzburg-Landau and put in place of c, c plus del c, and here c plus del c. Now, this quantity, I can do a Taylor expansion, fc plus del c, fc plus df del c, this is just a first order Taylor expansion. Now, and this quantity, del c plus del c square, so I now going to do that, grad c plus delta c square. So, now I multiply. That means, this, since this is a vector, this is a delta dot delta c, grad dot delta c. When I do that, I get delta c dot delta grad c, grad c, grad c square, and then grad delta c, grad delta c square. So, grad delta c square is a small term, so that is neglected because it is a nonlinear or a quadratic in fluctuation. Then two terms remain, 2 delta c, delta c. So, I can now go back, I will be and put all these things together, and that is given here, you know, you put this term there, then you realize that this term and this term, these two can be combined to get FR, this quantity, and I am left with this, I am left with, I am, okay, this combined, I am left with this term and this term which I collect here, and then I integrate these by parts, delta c delta c, and I can get this term. I integrate by parts, I will get delta square c delta. I brought the linear thing out, and then I do that. I am going little, I get the following equation. Delta fr is this quantity. This is the one now I am going to use to find out my chemical potential, and when I do that, put it together, this is the equation one gets, the Smoluchowski equation. Now the important thing is that with these equations are given there, you can, this is not difficult at all, it is just simple linear algebra, same thing you did in calculus. But the important thing is now I have an equation for small fluctuation, and that is of the following form. There is a diffusion, second order term, and the term DFDC. So in the next stage, one go and say, okay, I go back to original thing, that this equation is a very powerful equation, and lot of things can be done with the equation, but we are not going to do that now. We are doing something very simple, we are going to do just here. So my CR, my fluctuation I consider just around C naught, little fluctuation here, this little fluctuation. Then I say, okay, my DFDC term there, I can write like that, DFDC 0, and then second derivative. And this, of course, we know is DFDC here, maximum is 0, so that goes to 0. I am left with this term. If I do that, then I go back and put it back here, DC here, C is U plus C naught plus U, so it becomes DU DT. So then I get DU DT. D del square minus k square df. So this is the final equation, what you call linearized equation. And then something very very nice to it. So with this equation now, one very very simple thing one can do is that we can say, okay, if I have the small fluctuations, what happens to that fluctuations? So this is my small fluctuation. Now, is this fluctuation going to grow, or the fluctuation going to decay? If fluctuation going to decay, I am not going to get the phase separation or spinor decomposition. But if the fluctuation grows, then there is an instability, and that indeed happens. One introduce a Fourier analysis and does a Fourier space analysis here, and one can show that if that, because this equation is fully linear equation, I can do a Fourier transform. These become dk square, these become k small k square, this k square, and so k square plus k4. And then you get this equation k square and k square k4. I take k square out, and I just take the surface tension term out. So in this spinor decomposition, then we are talking of a small fluctuation in this initial, let us say we call it linearized regime, because u is very small. And the way, one of the way to study this kind of small fluctuations through a linearized equation like that is to go to Fourier space. We call this a stability analysis. So the stability analysis that we are doing here is a wonderful thing for stability of fluctuation. Even it's the same thing as the stability of that we do in the free energy with the that means whenever you do a fluctuation, if the energy increases as a result of fluctuation, then the system is stable. Like if I here, for example, I give a small fluctuation, if it stays, then it's stable. But if it is in a region like that, marginal stability, if it falls like that, then the energy decreases. Here in this case, gravitational energy. If by influence on fluctuation, free energy decreases, then the system is unstable. So this is the way we talk even in thermodynamics, the stability and instability, just because we look into the first derivative and second derivative. The same thing we are doing here. We already have a beautiful equation for the evolution of the small fluctuation here, and I want to know what happens to the small fluctuation, and this equation here is going to tell me what will happen to the small fluctuation. That equation already has a great character. It has a surface tension term which resists building of heterogeneity, and a free energy term which is helps in the phase separation. Okay, because it is, this term is coming from this term, that helps. But surface tension term, as I said, by diffusion. They don't like it. Okay, they don't like creation of surface reflection. That's why it comes with the negative term. And these two are opposite in sign. They fight against each other. And in that fight, who wins? That is called stability analysis. And the way to go to stability analysis is just introduce the Fourier. Why we do Fourier? It is simply because this equation is linear equation. It poised beautifully. So if I do Fourier transform in k square will term, another k square will term, so k4 term. So this case go with this and k4 go with that, and that exactly what happens. You know, this k square and k square k4 term, and this is the k square term. So now if I say okay, my this quantity, my fluctuation grows, it grows or decays with this omega k. So now I solve that. I said okay, if ukt is equal to e to the power minus wkt. So this is my equation. From this equation, I did nothing. I said okay, I have and introduce this definition, then I go back and do the Fourier transform. I find duk dt becomes omega k uk, and then that omega k is given by this term. And this equation means I have this solution. Now, if on a fluctuation, the fluctuation has to grow, then omega k has to be negative. If the fluctuation decays, then omega k will be positive. It's a very simple stability analysis that you probably have done in the stability analysis of your differential equations in your undergraduate. Those who have little mathematics course, they will have the stability analysis of the diffusion of a differential equation is a very thing, important thing to for a differential equation, whether it has a stable solution or not. Many solutions are neglected because they are not stable solutions. Okay, the same thing here we are doing, nothing really very fancy. So now I at the end of the day I get this solution, and omega k now is given by this thing. So this is a constant term, not important. So it is k square. So important thing is that k square plus 1 by k double, that is all. Now this quantity, remember, is negative because this is falling down. This quantity is positive at function of k. Now there will be a k, when, so small k, this is positive, but when, so this quantity that is coming from here falling down, so maximum second derivative is negative. So sorry, this is negative, but this is positive. Okay, so this is negative and this is positive. So very small k, this quantity is negative, but large k, this become positive. So when I go to large k, remember I have a negative sign in front of it. So when a large k, it becomes positive, that means the fluctuations decay, but at a very small k, this quantity wins, and then omega k becomes negative. If omega k becomes negative, I have a negative sign, then this quantity becomes positive. That means once inflation fluctuations grow, and there is a crossover, this is the crossover. So below that wave number, fluctuations, this is really interesting, as I said here, that below that wave number fluctuations grow, but then large wave number fluctuations stable. And this is exactly like our nucleation kind of thing. There is a surface term, is a diffusion term, and there is a free energy term. And so below that kc, system is unstable, but above that it is stable because this quantity is negative. So this is the stability analysis, and that explains the spinel decomposition. That why infinitesimal fluctuations can give rise to growth of patterns, and the pattern that grows with the wave number kc, because this is the where first time, because you are not going to go very large scale fluctuations, you are doing local small scale fluctuations, and you are trying to do local small fluctuations and you find your fluctuations just decay. However, suddenly you can have a fluctuation, you have particles B and B particles are brought together such that there is a fluctuation, a certain size of A, certain size of B are there, very much like nucleation. So these A and B are now can be stable now. So that particular is the KC, that magical wave number is the KC, and in KC that pattern now suddenly stabilizes, and then we know that is the pattern that can evolve. How do you know that all these things we are telling is right or wrong? Well, people go and can calculate this fluctuation correlation function by X-ray scattering. This is called structure factor. Just like we did wave number Fourier transform, this is the static structure factor that one gets by X-ray scattering or neutron scattering. So the maximum scattering occurs towards lower, then what happens that one, when do you get scattering? You do not get scattering from homogeneous system, you get scattering when there is an inhomogeneity, and because in order to scatter you have to have different regions of different density, okay, just like in light scattering you need to have different refractive index, and that exactly one sees that in X-ray scattering, that this peak, and as this the phase separation progresses, the peak is the manifestation of there is this regions. And these regions move to a lower and lower k value, this is k with time lower value, that this is the longest time T3. So, and that means what means my patterns becoming thicker and thicker, and phase separation is going on more and more. So, the scattering shifts towards lower values, this is known as coarsening, very important thing in the phase transition language, coarsening, coarse graining. So, system is coarse graining itself. Evolves toward a phase separated state. So, I think this is the end of this spinoral decomposition. To summarize, that it's a wonderful subject to end the phase transition for the time being. We'll back with the critical phenomena later, and this is the kind of situation we are describing, and this is the kind of coarsening behavior. So this is very different from nucleation, but the, at the same time exceedingly common and popular, and is not really taught in statistical mechanics courses, but as soon as you go into the realm of research, this is one of the first thing that you face, just like nucleation. And I think students should be prepared for this kind of things rather than knowing lot of equations and lot of partition functions, they are fine. And they get us started, but they do not really lead you to a very interesting and important areas of research, and do not allow you, for example, to read research papers on nanomaterials and other things where you will see their college talks on nucleation, they thermodynamic control or kinetic control, they are talking of Becker-Dorin-Zeldovich, they are talking of spinoral decomposition. But this is it, because I think students should read at the level of BSc or MSc these kind of things. So this is where we stop now, and we'll return soon with another dose of phase transition, and then we'll go over to more mundane and but more detailed things of liquid state theory and more interacting system, Ising models, and phase transition, and many other things are there, like how to do binary mixtures, how to talk of surface tension, many other things. Okay.